Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Robin Colucci here. She's an author and a book coach, and she might be the only book coach on the planet who'll tell you that you might never need to write a book, ever. You might want to do something else. So you want to stay tuned to find out what that is. And we'll be back right after this message.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Robin Colucci, who is the author of How to Write a Book That Sells You and High Profit Book Blueprint, 7 Steps to Write and Publish a Booklet That Attracts Dream Clients and Grows Your Business. She has been helping world-class experts write world-changing books since 2003. It's so nice to have you here, Robin.
Well, thank you so much, Diane. It's a great pleasure to be here with you today.
Well, I'm excited to talk about this. This is a little different of a topic. I've had a lot of book writing experts, but not booklet so much. And I thought it was really interesting that you said you tell people they might not need to write a book ever. So I wanted, before I get into that, I want to get a little backstory on you of how you got interested in this field. And just, can you give me just your backstory?
Sure, absolutely. Well, I was always prone towards writing. I come from a long line of writers, and so I just had the genes for it. And I did a lot of writing as a kid. And when it was time to go to college, my mother said, "Why don't you major in journalism? And that way you could get paid to write." Which, you know, looking back on with the 2020, you know, vision of hindsight, journalism is definitely not the best way to get paid to write anymore.
Yeah, that was a different time.
Right. But I did. I also had been very inspired by people like Barbara Walters and Woodward and Bernstein, you know, with the whole Watergate expose and everything.
Right.
And so I was turned on by that idea. So I majored in journalism at George Washington University. And I worked part-time at the Washington Post as a news aide while I was in college.
Wow.
Which was super fun and amazing.
Yeah.
And actually, while I was there, Bob Woodward was still there.
Oh, really?
And so that was kind of cool. Yeah. Uh-huh. He was in charge of the newsroom on Sundays when Ben Bradley was off.
Wow.
And one thing that everybody loved about Bob Woodward is every Sunday evening, he'd send a news aide out with $40 to go get 2 big things of Baskin and Robbins ice cream to bring back to the newsroom for everyone to have a treat.
Nice.
So that made Bob very popular with the news aides.
Not to mention his writing.
Exactly.
That's funny.
And so as I was getting close to graduation, my chairman of the journalism department called me into his office and he said, "Hey, I've recommended you for a job with a New York Times bestselling author. And if he offers you the job, you should leave the post to take it."
Hmm.
And at first I was very, you know, incredulous about this idea, but he said, just go. And with an open mind. So I promised that I would. And I went, and I was offered a job with David Wise, who wrote the very first ever expose on the CIA. Called The Invisible Government, and he wrote many books afterwards, including 3 while I was working for him in the late 1980s. And when I finished my work with him, and by the way, this is where I learned just about everything I still use today in dealing with literary agents, publishing house editors, national level book launches. I really learned in my 3 years with David. The technology has changed, but nothing else has. the standards and how you communicate, and you know, it's all pretty much in place. And so, but after I finished the 3 years, our agreement was he would help me get a newspaper reporting job, which he did. And I moved to Central Florida to work for a mid-sized paper down there. And it was completely different than my experience of being at the Washington Post in terms of standards and quality and just the whole culture. And the culture was a massive shock to me. And so I left. And not only did I leave that newspaper, I left journalism, and I thought I was leaving publishing. I actually moved to Colorado and got a job as a waitress because I just was not. Yeah, I was like, I'm not doing this anymore. And I ended up starting, building, growing, and ultimately selling a personal fitness training business.
Huh.
Which I know, and it's
different.
See, there's
that's
no
a little
really
different.
Reader's Digest uh-huh. version of my right. Uh-huh.
right, right. Well, that makes detour. It more interesting. And, I like that.
Right. A 10-year detour. You know, I had been a competitive gymnast in college, so I was always kind of into fitness and anatomy and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
But so I did that, and it was a really fun job. But I ultimately sold it because I realized that while it was fun, it wasn't my calling. Didn't know what my calling was, but I knew it wasn't being a fitness professional. So I thought, well, I'll be a business coach for wellness professionals because I had successfully built and sold a fitness business.
Right.
And if there's one thing I learned 10 years in the industry is a lot of people in the health and wellness field are really great at what they do and really passionate about what they do, but they're not really great at business or sales or marketing. So I did that for a little while and my clients got some great results. Actually, one of them was on the verge of bankruptcy with her Anytime Fitness franchise. And in 3 months, we turned it around so she could sell it for $60,000.
Wow.
So that was pretty cool.
That's good.
And so I was having a good time with it, but an interesting thing started to happen, which was several of my clients started to say, you know, what I really want to do is write a book. And
you get
I was like,
a lot of
oh,
people say that. I know.
I totally uh-huh. could help you with that. Like, I know exactly how to do that. And all
right.
of a sudden, I'm, you know, back in my mentor's office, you know, on Connecticut Avenue in D.C. and
yeah.
And so I started to do that. And then I realized that it wasn't publishing I was done with. It was daily newspaper reporting. And that what I really loved was doing books.
Right. So
and
the writing you love.
Yeah.
Well, I think a lot of people think that they can write, but it's hard, you know, and a lot of people need help. Now, do you do the ghost writing for people at all?
We do both. So we offer book coaching. I now have a small team of outstanding writers that work with me, and we do both writing coaching and we do ghost writing. And that really depends on the needs of the client.
You know, writing's really an interesting thing to me. When just writing a doctoral dissertation was a very fun experience. Just the nitpicky things that they had. You think you've got it perfect, and then you'd get your paper back, and it, you know how it
right.
like it's brutal. It's just red, and you're like, wasn't there some ink on this paper?
Wasn't there anything black here? Right.
Yeah, and you know, it made me a different writer. So, I mean, scholarly writing's a whole lot different in so many aspects, but it helped me a lot in just writing in general to see what they wanted, and then writing a book is so different. And then a lot of times I've used sites like Grammarly just to catch, you know, dangling participles or whatever the things are
you can't
do. But it's different when you write a book because you kind of want to end sentences and prepositions and do weird stuff that you wouldn't do in a scholarly paper. So I always find it so fascinating. When do you go by the Grammarlys and when do you not? And it's hard, don't you think?
It is. And I think that I can see the value in something like Grammarly, and it does catch a lot of stuff that that also any copy editor would catch. Mm-hmm. But I also think, like, every time I write a blog post, you know, it'll tell me like how many of my sentences are too long, right? Or something
right,
like that.
Right.
And
that's helpful.
And I mean, mm-hmm. that is helpful, mm-hmm. but there's no need to fix every single one, because sometimes it's just better
right,
to
right.
have a longer
that's my,
sentence.
That's my point is yeah. when is it capturing yeah. a certain sentiment on purpose? You know mm-hmm. what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think you yeah. do more of that in the book writing, booklet writing world yeah. than you do in the scholarly whatever world, you know?
Well, absolutely. Because we have to remember, like, just think about place for a second. Like, when you're reading a scholarly work, you might be sitting at your desk or even in a library. But when you're reading a book or a booklet, you're probably reading it in bed, right? Hmm. So, or you're reading it in the bathroom, regardless, or your favorite chair, your favorite reading chair, but you're reading it in an intimate space.
Uh-huh.
And so I think it's really important for authors to realize when you're writing a book, where your reader's going to be reading it, and to treat that relationship with the respect and intimacy that it requires. And that also enables you to, you can mindfully break some rules here and there and have a conversation with your reader where they feel like they're in an intimate conversation with you and not just being talked at. And so I think it's a huge opportunity, and this is one of the reasons why I'm such an advocate of writing a book to grow your business, because where else do you get 6 hours of undivided attention with your ideal client in bed? You know,
I don't know if I want to answer that, but go ahead.
Don't
okay.
allow for that, right? And so, and really, it's such an unbelievable, unprecedented opportunity. I mean, Pepsi can spend $30 million on a Super Bowl ad and they'll never get that kind of access to your ideal client that you can have. And so it's really a powerful thing, but it's also something that needs to be respected.
Well, you know, I think it's really interesting when you bring this up. It just brings back, I never intended to write a book at all in the past. And then you used to, right. you know, you hear, the book is a new business card. You hear all that stuff now. But back when I was writing, I actually thought, oh, it'd be kind of interesting to take a writing course. And mm-hmm. so I took I don't even think it was nonfiction. Maybe it was. I can't remember. I think it was a nonfiction. And the person teaching the course was an agent who had a New York Times bestselling book. I didn't know, you know. And she's like, she wanted to be my agent and to represent me and do all this stuff. I'm like, I don't even know what I'm doing, you know. So, but what I learned was the, you know, writing proposals and what agents could do for mm-hmm. you. And I learned sure. a lot of different things. She wanted me to write in an irreverent tone. Skinny bitch was popular mm-hmm. back then. And I just didn't write that way. And she kind of wanted me to be like Susie Orman and write finance stuff. And I didn't really want to do that. So I ended mm-hmm. up doing my own thing in a different direction. But I learned a lot from having an agent, just how a sure. proposal should look. And, yep. you know, and you're kind of going in a different direction. You're with this booklet thing, which I think is really interesting because I know a lot of people are writing booklets instead of books now.
Right.
Talk a little bit about what a booklet is and why is that an important thing?
Well, yeah. So, because really, like, the bulk of our business is actually helping people do book proposals and mm-hmm. connecting them with literary agents and helping them get book deals and then mm-hmm. writing the book with them once they have the deal.
That's hard to do. That's not easy. They need help. People.
Yeah,
need...
and it's great to do the proposal before you connect with the agent, because then we can match you to an agent who wants to support the brand that you're creating and doesn't have their own idea of your brand, you know.
So, yeah, that's true. That's a good point.
And that is an important thing. But the reason I created the booklet is because of the hundreds of people I had to turn away.
Yeah. Oh, I can't imagine how many people.
Right. Uh-huh. And I realized, like, I had been saying to people for years, and if anybody's listening that I said this to, please accept my apology again, because I've already apologized to everybody on my list who I did this to, uh-huh. is I would say to them, you know, you're not quite ready to write a full-length book. Mm-hmm. And if you invest in writing a full-length book now, before you really have a business, before you have clients, before you've made very many sales or really have any track record, you're going to feel productive and you're going to feel like you're growing your business, but you are going to bury yourself because you're going to spend $40,000 producing and, you know, writing, producing a book that you have no audience for. And you'll have wasted at least a year thinking you're productive when you should have been making sales. And then you're going to be in trouble.
Do you know, I think what they don't understand is a lot of them think that they're going to just sell books. And okay, and to make back $40,000, you'd have to sell so many books. And
right. And, you, and books, if you're going to sell that many books, you've got to have a platform. And if you don't have a platform, if you don't have a business, you definitely don't have a platform. And so, and I said, go grow your business. Now, here's what I apologize for. Grow your business. Uh-huh. And then when you have something, a growing concern, then come back and I'll help you write a book. Mm-hmm. And I realized what I was doing was just kicking them, you know, like they'd come up to the side of the boat. And instead of throwing them a lifeline, I threw them back to the sharks in the shark infested waters of book coaching, where not everybody has the same scruples, and plenty of people would be more than happy to take their money to help them write a book when they're not ready.
Right. Oh yeah.
So this troubled me for years because I always knew it was a terrible answer, but I just didn't know what a better answer would be. And then actually one day, one of my former clients who got a traditional book deal said, well, why don't you just help them write a booklet? And I realized, well, yeah, that's an appropriate investment of time and money for somebody who needs a quick authority piece just to help them get off the ground. Because, yes, it does help your authority. It does give you something to, you know, to say, I'm an author. I have this book. Even if it's just for 7,000 to 10,000 words of value-packed content, you know, it can really help somebody who's just getting started to use as a tool to help them grow their
business.
And
you're talking about nonfiction books. You're not saying write fiction that way, right?
No, we don't. I do so little fiction that I just say I don't do fiction.
Right.
Like I have a couple of clients I've helped with fiction who've done very well, but it's always been an exception I've made because
like
of extreme talent.
Who wrote my cheese?
not even that. Yeah, like very, very, very rarely.
I don't know what that falls under, is it?
That would be fiction, actually. Yeah, that's like, I call that fable. I've done a very little bit of fable, but I really, nonfiction is our main deal.
Well, I think, you know, anybody starting to write a book, I mean, if you ever did get in touch with an agent or somebody, if you skipped to that point somehow in your ways, you'll find out if the word platform will be beaten over your head until you bleed profusely. So your platform is your following. How many people are going to buy your book, basically? And they want to make sure a lot of people are going to buy your book. And I could see that a booklet's going to sell for less. It's going to be, you know, less, you know, of an outlay for people. And I think I could see that we're going to see more of those. It's kind of almost like a white paper on steroids, right?
Yeah. I mean, you get an opportunity to provide a taste of the value that you could offer a potential customer down the road. And so they get a chance to get to know you better and what you get a better sense of your philosophy or your approach. And you can do it without spending 6 to 9 months writing and then another several months going through the publishing process.
Now, I
wrote my booklet in 5 hours.
Oh, really?
No, so I am not a hybrid. And what we do is when we facilitate somebody, we help them, you know, we have a small group online masterclass, booklet writing masterclass that they can join for under $1,000. And then when they're ready to put their booklet into production, we have a partner that we work with to, you know, do the copy editing, interior design, cover design, layout, all that stuff, and help them get their Amazon page up and do an Amazon bestseller launch for them. A real one where actually people actually download and read their book.
Right. You're not like, just in like a category that's
yeah,
that
exactly,
one thing.
Exactly. Like real legitimate
real
category.
Real category. And,
right. And but we give them all the publishing rights. So we don't take any of their sales. We don't take any work. So we're not a hybrid publisher. Mm-hmm. We just help them with packaging the booklet. And launching
and a lot
it,
of people
but we don't
need
yeah.
help with that. I remember when CreateSpace was first out, I used that, and now it's mm-hmm. all, you know, KDP and all the stuff that whatever they're called now. But it's interesting to go through the process of just the first book is always the hardest, and you learn so much, and it's nice to have somebody to guide you through that, you know. And
true.
And to start even with a booklet though, there's don't you have to have a certain outline or organization or any of that?
Oh, yeah.
So when you do these classes or training, what kinds mm-hmm. of things are they learning in those?
Well, I actually give them a good basic structure that they mm-hmm. can use to, because I look at the booklet as having a very specific purpose, which is to connect with a potential ideal prospect for somebody's coaching or consulting business, usually. Is really the most of the people who are doing booklets with us. That's what they're trying to do. Mm-hmm. And so we give them a proposed outline but they don't have to follow the outline. But basically you want to dispel the myths that your competitors are perpetuating. And then you want to start to unpack your key, you know, maybe your five top key ideas or five steps or you know, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And you want to sprinkle in a couple of different places, not like in an exhaustive way, but you sprinkle in a couple of key points in the booklet, a link to some free offer. And this is really important because if you're selling your booklet on Amazon, which I recommend, because it makes your booklet more findable.
Right.
And so if you're selling your booklet on Amazon,
right? mm-hmm.
yeah, you're not getting the email addresses of your most interested readers from Amazon, but if you have a couple of offers for some free downloads or something, then you can get those readers to go to those links and opt into to get the free offer. And then you have that ability to market to them indefinitely. And help
I think that's really important, you know, and I, as you're saying that, I've watched some of the great, course development courses of how, you know, all the ways to develop your lead magnets and all that stuff. And I don't think enough people put them in their books. And I think that mm-hmm. when you have it, you have, like you said, Amazon, you don't know who's buying your book and you get your 25 cents, but you don't know where it came from, whatever it is that
exactly.
they pay you, but you get your money. And I think, you know, I think that is a really key thing. For people to learn about, you know, the kinds of, especially you can create links so you can tell where people are getting it from your Amazon or something else, depending on what they put in. And so I mm-hmm. think all of that is mm-hmm. something to be really taught to people. I'm working with someone right now. I am helping her create her course content and different things. And some of the suggestions I had was kind of a booklet kind of thing because she does reverse mortgages. And she, there is so much that she gives out in these, you know, these lead magnet opt-in kind of articles that are so great. Do you ever suggest that people take, you know, like a compilation of their different lead magnet type things they've created and make it into one big booklet?
Well, only if it would flow gracefully, you know.
Maybe like the top 10 things you need, and then maybe each one could be a chapter of a tiny chapter, maybe.
Yeah, exactly, because mm-hmm. the booklet doesn't really need to be more than 10,000 words, you know, which is part of the beauty of it. So if you have mm-hmm. the top 10 things, and mm-hmm. you give maybe, you know, 750 words to each of the 10, and then you have some word count left for the intro and the conclusion or the, you know, the outro, then quite tidy. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Work. How much do you recommend people charge for something like that?
Well, you know, I mean, I don't think it needs to be very much. I think that, you know, you just, it's really, This is where my book package or
people need to.
No, you're not going to get rich from this. Well, you understand. No, here's the thing: you're not going to get rich from the book
from
sales.
The book. Yeah.
You're not from the book sales.
It's the leads you get from the book, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you wanted to, you could give it away to a carefully curated list of people that you think would be interested in, you know, that you would love to have as clients. But please don't just shove it down their throats at an event or leave a stack of them on your table at an event. Not that we do events anymore, or hardly anymore. But really, I think, you know, and this is, I'm stumbling on the pricing because this is where my book packager is more expert than I am. Mm-hmm. But as I recall, you know, we're under $10 on the booklet and we're probably under $5
now. Are these actual printed books or are they more like Kindle books that you're having them?
I recommend doing both. Mm-hmm. I mean, as long as you've done it, you might as well
have options.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And you know, I think that here's something I really believe: you should definitely get a print version, and then as long as you got the print version, the Kindle conversion's really easy.
Right.
But the thing is, think about it for a second. Like, somebody got your booklet, maybe they ordered it off Amazon, maybe they got it, you know, at an event, or mm-hmm. maybe you sent it to them as a gift. Guess where that lives?
Yeah.
It doesn't live on your hard, on their hard drive where they might never think of it or see it. It lives somewhere in their house.
Right.
Where they're probably seeing it several times a week. And, you know, that basic rule of marketing of like 9 touches, or, you know, before mm-hmm. somebody even responds, well, that could be happening. You know, one little area where your booklet could be doing a lot of heavy lifting for you just by sitting in someone's house.
You know, and it's,
especially if it's by their bedside, which is likely.
It's really not that hard. I think a lot of people freak out about creating a cover and a title and, you know, and all that stuff can be changed on Amazon so easily. Not the title so much, but the cover. And some of the stuff, I can't tell you how many times I changed one of my book covers. I got so tired of what it was.
Oh my God.
Because it was one of my old books. And I'm like, well, you know, because she had been, my agent had wanted me to do this irreverent thing. So the picture was more irreverent.
Right.
And I'm like, yeah, I can't live with that. So.
Yeah, if you didn't feel it. Yeah.
No, I never did. Sense. And yeah. I love the title though. It was, It's Not You, It's Your Personality. It was about personality assessments. And so the title was always fine.
That is cute.
But,
yeah.
But that was a long time ago. And I think, you know, I've learned a lot since. And I think a lot of people get worried about how hard it is to do certain things where they have to spend a lot of money to do certain things. And there's so many people who can help you. And what you're offering is really helpful to so many people, because there's just, you know, especially if you're helping with proposals and agents, and that's the hardest part for a lot of people. What percent of people do your agents want to work with? You know what I mean? It's hard, isn't it?
Well, what's interesting is we have an interesting statistic that mm-hmm. every time I say it out loud, I knock on something wood, or I try mm-hmm. to. Yeah. I'm going to do it again. So, so far, we have a 100% success rate placing our clients with agents who go on to sell their books.
Wow. Wow.
Now, the caveat is, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I've had agents, well, my agent, you know, had a hard time selling the one book that I had her working on, because, you know, there's always somebody out there who's written something similar, and they're like, oh, we've done enough of that. Don't you run into that a little bit?
Well, we try not to. Our first step is we help our clients come up with a clear sellable concept, and mm-hmm. one of the criteria is that it has to be unique, and obviously mm-hmm. people are writing in the space. But, mm-hmm. you know, one of the problems, I mean, I'm not saying anything specifically against your agent, but one of the problems with chasing a trend is uh-huh. that if you're a little late to the party, then you're not going to get it. You know, you're going to have trouble getting a deal. Uh-huh. You're not going to get as good of a deal. And so it's more about like figuring out what does this author authentically want to share? You know, what's the thing that's gnawing at you mm-hmm. that's begging to be shared? And then how can we figure out where that message meets the market? And that's where we begin. So, you know, the caveat to our success rate is that we only accept people into the program that have ideas that we believe we can sell.
Mm-hmm.
right. And,
makes sense.
And, you know, and that are also ready for it, right? Mm-hmm. And this only applies to people who actually complete the process and do what we tell them to do. So, but with those things in place, you know, we've been very fortunate. I have a nice, not a huge network of agents, but I have a solid network of agents that's big enough that, you know, and of course, I'm always open to meeting a new agent, by the way, but, you know, they know me, they know that when they get a proposal from me, and that even if it's not a fit, it's going to be a great read.
Right.
And so, so we get highly responsive.
So your proposals are for books and not booklets, obviously, right?
Oh yeah. You're not going to get a book deal on a booklet.
Right. Right. And so for a book is another beast than a booklet. And that's going to take some time. Right. And I think a lot of people think they could just write it and it'll be out on the market within a few weeks, you know, and it doesn't work that way. How long does it normally take from the time you meet somebody before they actually have a print book in their hand and it's available on the market?
Yeah, well, self-publishing is a lot faster.
Right.
So the fastest I've ever helped someone to write a high-quality self-published book is 4 months.
Right.
And then you have to add on a few more months for production.
Right.
Now, for traditionally published, you know, the calendar is not fully within the author's control. Publishers have spent a lot of money on their market research, and they know that certain books tend to perform better at certain times of year. So if you turn in your manuscript, they may sit on it for 4 or 5 months before they even move it into production because they want to release it in a particular season. So that process can, the fastest I've ever helped someone from meeting them to getting the book proposal done to writing the book and getting it published was 1 year.
Yeah, that'd be fast.
But that was extraordinarily fast.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
And part of it had to do with this person. It seemed like every time I would send him an email of the next step, he'd have it done. It almost seemed to me before the email could have possibly hit his inbox. Like, I've never worked with anyone faster in my life, which was really fun. But like, at first it was disarming. At first it was like, I was completely like freaked out, but then I realized it was really fun, and it really forced me to kind of change my perspective on what was possible.
Yeah.
Right.
I am that guy. I've had some professors. I can remember having a professor who got really mad at me because I would turn things in too quickly. And
right.
So I would just hold on to it for a week or two and then turn it in and do the exact same thing, but just to make him think I spent more time. And then he'd go, "See how much better that was?" And I'm like, "No, you're..."
I know. I'd be like, okay, he wants something else. Okay, here, do this. And I'd be like, that should keep him, give him something to chew on for the next couple of days. And then like 4 hours later or something, it would be in my inbox. And
exactly.
I'd be like, oh my gosh.
That's exactly what
I would
do.
But, you know, it was fabulous. Mm-hmm. And he got it done so quickly. And, you know, he got a book, an agent and a book deal.
What kind of topics are people coming to you with? What kinds of things are popular?
Well, we're very fortunate to get a lot of variety. Mm-hmm. We do a lot in the business leadership space.
Yeah, I'll bet.
We also,
there's a lot out there.
That's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we do a lot in the health, fitness, and medical space. We also have been doing more in social justice, which I love, or racial justice, social justice. We're starting to get more of that, and I'm really loving that we get that opportunity to work with some of those authors. And environment is another one that has been, we're doing more of recently than we have in previous years.
Well, it's such an interesting field to be, I don't know, I remember Seth Godin had just self-published when I was writing one a long time ago, and it just changed everything of what people could do. Do you think that there are too many books now that it's hard to stand out and be a bestseller? You know what I'm saying? It's just everybody's writing now.
Yeah, well, I think, I don't want to say there might be too many books just because there are maybe too many people writing books before it's really the right time. And, And I think that I think self-publishing is great in that it really empowers people to have total control over their authoring future. But I think it's unfortunate that it's also created a lot of, you know, there's a lot of books out there that aren't necessarily at the quality that anybody would want to read, because there's no real standard in self-publishing that's enforceable in the same way it is in traditional publishing. And so it's a challenge, but I think that, you know, the pandemic, if it proved anything, was that people are still really into books. They want their physical book, not just their ebook. They want to hold it in their hands and smell the paper. And
I wish they would change with that though. With the real books, is, you know, when people ask me to sign a book for them and can you send me a signed book? Well, if you have them, you're paying a certain amount to have the book, even if they say they'll reimburse you or whatever. But then, it costs more to ship the book once you sign.
Yes.
Can somebody listening to this create a way to sign books through Amazon where you don't have to actually have the book and then resend it out again? That would be the company to start.
Wouldn't that be lovely? I used to, every time a client would sign up, I would send them an autographed copy of my book, but I became such a bottleneck to doing it that, you know, sometimes it would take weeks for a new client to get my book.
It's just ridiculously
expensive.
So
now we just send it right from Amazon, because it just,
yeah,
like you said, it was more like it would have to be a thing. Like I would have to, I wouldn't just run to the post office when I had one book, right? So I'd wait till I had a few new clients and then I'd go to the post office and send everybody's at once. But it was like a big,
and it's a long time to get a book if you do the cheap route, and I don't want people to wait, and you know what I mean?
I would send it priority and all that, but
it's like 15 bucks or something when you send a book, you know. And so
and if you want to do it overseas, forget about it. I never would send it overseas.
Well, I did. Okay, so get this. I was on this board of advisors for this very, very you know, well-known, extremely profitable, great company. And everybody, there was 250 of us on this board or something like that, some crazy amount of people.
Wow.
And they were all like the CEOs of Sony or McDonald's or whatever, whatever they are. You know, I mean, just like the serious people. And I'm on this board going, this is great. You know, the former CEO and chairman of that had written part of this, my foreword of the book. And so I thought, well, I'm just going to contact this group because they're just such great people and see if they'd like a copy, because they'd love, probably because he wrote that. And I'm figuring maybe 10, 20 people.
Okay.
So I got like 150 of them, and most of them weren't in the U.S. We were all over the world. Oh, I spent a fortune doing that, but I still was glad I did it. But it was just, it was not what I expected, because they all took me up on it. But so
if only you'd had a booklet, it would have been a little cheaper.
It would have been
not cheaper enough.
No, you know, for all the trouble you go through,
overseas. Like when we would have to ship even a booklet to Canada, you know, it was surprisingly expensive.
Well, people will ask too, you know, and you don't want to say no, and you don't want to charge them for it. And it's a really uncomfortable kind of thing, you know. They got to maybe come up with a way that there's pre-done signature cards that they could stamp it with, so it's special or something. I don't know. But I think what you're doing is really important for so many people. Is there any big mistakes or anything that you want to tell people to, like, avoid? I mean, what are the big things that people run into?
Yeah. Well, do you have a specific area you'd like me to focus?
Self-publishing in general, I guess.
Self-publishing
a regular book. What are the biggest issues you think people really need to know?
I think that, there's a few. And I'd say the first big mistake I see people make is even in deciding what to write about. And you got to ask yourself a few key questions before you decide exactly what your book's focus is going to be. And one is, how do you want to be known? Because you will be known by your book. So just because all your friends tell you should write about that thing that happened with that guy doesn't mean it should be a book. Okay. So number two, and this is connected, is this something that you would like to be talking about for the next 5 years? And not just talking about, but leading the conversation on.
Right.
Because if you don't want to lead a conversation on the subject for 5 years, a book is way too much work and not worth it. You find some other way to talk about it.
Right.
Like, you know, write a blog post and be done with it. And the other is, how are you going to use the book? Like, what do you see yourself doing with the book once it's out?
Who's
and what do you
audience,
want your
right?
readers? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what do you want your readers to do with the book once they have it? So this is more about like how are you going to use your book as a tool to help you further your bigger vision, your bigger mission, or grow your business or whatever it is you're up to? Because again, it's just too much of an investment not to consider those things. And I actually surveyed. I had 300. This is like years ago. I had found 300 self-published authors on my email list, and I called every one of them and surveyed them and asked them how these were not people who'd worked with me, they just happened to be on my list.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked them about how pleased they were with their outcomes, and most of them were very disappointed with their outcomes.
In
and then when I started asking
sales
them,
or in terms of what,
yeah, they just they thought they were gonna put it up on Amazon and sell 100,000 copies.
Oh, I bet you got a very high percentage saying that. Okay, yes,
right. Mm-hmm. And I was and I found out, well, and I started asking them these questions. And they had not done, they had not asked themselves those questions. And so they were just disappointed because the book didn't do something for them. They didn't realize that it's about like, what can you do with the book for yourself?
Right,
it's
right.
not about the book doing something for you. So, and then the other big mistake, so that's another category of not being clear on, the big mistake of not being clear on why you're writing this book and like getting the right topic. Then the other big mistake is thinking you're going to write a high quality book in a weekend. And unfortunately, people sell this idea. But I'm telling you, and you know, I don't have to tell you, Diane, because I know you already know this. You cannot write a high quality book in a weekend.
No.
I'd even challenge you,
you
to say you can't
even
draft. You can't even write a first draft. You can't even write a crappy first draft of a high quality full length book in a weekend. Now you can map out a really detailed outline.
right.
But I think that when people promote that idea of writing a book in a weekend, what they're missing is one of the things that actually, probably the main thing that actually makes you a better authority, like the reason why author, the idea of being an author has such prestige, is because the whole idea is that you take some time and use it as an opportunity for inquiry, both self-inquiry to figure out what do you really believe, what do you really mean to say versus your sloppy, lazy way of saying it when you're just talking off the top of your head, because it's different. And I'm, by the way, speaking from my own experience too, right, when I wrote my book. So I'm not just
right.
But we just do. We say flippant, hand-wavy things when we're talking, but you can't get away with that in a book, right? Or you shouldn't try to get away with that in a book. And so so really that self-inquiry, what do I really mean to say? And are the words I'm using actually conveying what I'm trying to communicate?
Right.
Well, and if you do this, it's a superpower that you can take with you in every conversation you have. So it's worth it to do the inquiry. You can't do that inquiry in a weekend.
Well, I think, you know, I think that you have to have a passion, like you said, for your topic. And you had mentioned that you come from a long line of authors. And you know what is funny to me? I found out my great-grandfather wrote a book. And I had no idea. I knew my dad wrote books, but I didn't know my great-grandfather had written a book. So I found it online.
Oh.
And it was like on eBay or something. And I think it was written in 1894 or something. It was
that's so cool.
It's such a cool thing to look at. But this guy wrote a book. It's like 500 pages of the different hands you can play in the game of whist, which is like bridge, basically. It is the most neurotic thing. you would have to, it's really well done. It was Brentano's. I mean, it was a serious, he was known as like the whist expert. And he wrote a book called Modern Scientific Whist, The Principles of the Modern Game, Analyzed and Extended. Yeah, it's very analyzed and extended. It's just, I'm fascinated by this, that who would read this? No one, incredible. First of all. But I guess if you're really, I don't know who would write that. But I would like to have met my grandfather, this guy, right? Who wrote this, because with the magic, imagine knowing that much. You'd have to go through, it's like taking every hand you can play in bridge and showing what it is and what you would play next.
Whew.
That's a nutty book. I was really fascinated by that. Anyway.
It must have been quite an undertaking for
him. I wanted to know how long that would take you. I mean,
right.
But you know,
definitely longer than a weekend.
Most definitely. You know, it's so funny. My uncle wrote a book. I found all these people wrote books. You know, and it's fascinating to see how, you know, if you have it in you, you know, you want to get it onto the printed page. And I think that people really can get a lot of help from somebody like you who's really worked in the serious end of the business and has great, you know, tips of how to get more recognition and how to, you know, organize it and everything like that. So if somebody wanted to hire you to do this, or if they're an agent and they want to get connected to you or whatever, is there some kind of a way they can reach you?
Easily, robincolucci.com, and we have a contact form on there. If you're wanting to reach out like as an agent, the contact form is the great way to go, or we also have an application form on there as well for people who are interested in finding out more about our program and seeing if we can help or how we might be able to help them achieve their publishing goals.
Well,
and help them find the right reach. You know, for what,
if they want to take your master class, that's all there, right?
Yep, exactly. Okay. And we can, they can find out about that. We also, if you go any page on our website and opt in, we periodically open up that class for new registrations, and so they would be notified, you know, just by being on our list when the next opportunity is.
Well, I think that I think a lot of people can benefit from those kind of courses. I know I offer some of those on my site for different things, and I think people love that because you get that interactive and you could figure out all the things that you don't realize you don't know until you get involved. And I think it's really important for people who are thinking of writing a book to look at how they can use it down the road and not just be thinking about how many copies they could sell, because the copies are not nearly the money you could make as for compared to what you could use it for as a business tool, don't you think?
Oh, I know for sure. Mm-hmm. And, you know, even the clarity you get coming up with a clear sellable concept can already start to help you raise your income even before you write the book.
Yeah.
If you're asking those questions,
those are so really important. Powerful. Well, this has been so helpful, Robin. Thank you so much for sharing, and I hope everybody takes some time to check out your site. I had a lot of fun chatting with us about this topic with you, because it's a really unusual thing to think about, booklets, and people need to have a lot of help in the writing arena. So thank you.
Well, thank you, Diane. I've had so much fun chatting with you today as well.
That was fun. And we will be back right after this message. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank Robin for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on this show. If you've missed any past episodes, you can go to drdianehamilton.com. There's so much content there. Of course, if you go to the blog, you can read the shows as well as listen to them. And you can find out more about Cracking the Curiosity Code and The Power of Perception, and all the books that I've written are all there. And the Curiosity Code Index and the Perception Power Index are there if you want to take the assessments. So make sure you look at all the drop-down menus at the top, and on the bottom, there's more menus. So make sure you take a look, because there's testimonials and so much more at the bottom. So you don't want to miss it all. And really enjoyed today's episodes. And I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio.